It's great to see you today. Welcome to Church at All Saints. My name's Tom Barrett. I'm one of the ministers here. Today is the first Sunday where masks are not required in churches in New South Wales. Many of you are enjoying that freedom. But can I just say, you're still very welcome to wear a mask if you choose to, for your own sake or for the sake of others. I'll be wearing my mask a bit, so it's okay to wear one. It's okay not to wear one. That's where we're at today, the day of freedom. Hello to those who are joining us online because you can't be here in person. Good morning to you this morning. Thanks for joining us. We gather together this morning to meet with a God who is not like us. He is different. He is bigger. He is better. He is more pure. In the Old Testament, we read the prophet Isaiah telling us of the time when he saw a vision of God's throne room. Here's what he says. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the whole temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. As we start our service this morning, we're going to join in that song of rejoicing in God's specialness, his holiness, his purity, his power. Let's see if we can shake the doorposts as we sing his praises now. Let's stand and sing.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he, and together we up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he, and together we sing, everyone sing.
Amen. Please grab a seat. When Isaiah saw that vision of God on his throne in all his holiness, his initial response was not joy. We read in Isaiah 6, at the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Isaiah recognized that in the face of God's holiness, his sinfulness was a serious problem. And left to our own devices, judged by our own behavior, we are in the same boat. And so as we continue, we're going to pray a prayer of thanks, of confession, prayer of confession, recognizing where we stand before God if we're left on our own two feet. Let's pray together. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. After Isaiah's word of despair, he records, then one of the seraphim, those weird flying things, flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it, he touched my mouth. And he said, see, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. This is our story too, as people who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Last week in Colossians, we read that for those who belong to Jesus, God has qualified us to share in the inheritance of his holy people. He has rescued us out of the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have freedom, the forgiveness of sins. This morning as we gather, that we meet with the holy God in confidence because we belong to Jesus who forgives all our sins. We're going to turn now to God's word for the encouragement and guidance that we get from the scriptures. Our second reading today will be from Colossians, continuing our series, Onward in Christ, and Leigh Zadro will be unpacking that for us. But before that, we're going to read from the Old Testament, from the book of Job. This is some Old Testament wisdom literature. It's a book that tells a story of a man who's gone through amazing loss and suffering and grief. He rightfully brings that to God in questioning and lament and complaint. But as he debates with his friends, his faithful questioning eventually ends up condemning God and justifying himself. And the chapter we're going to read, God shows up to give a bit of perspective on the situation. Graham's going to read that for us. Thank you, Graham.
The first Bible reading is Job chapter 38. Verses 1 to 21, and if you've got a large print church Bible, it's on page 761. Job chapter 38, verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? when I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no farther. Here is where your proud waves halt. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place, that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the deepest darkness? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. What is the way of the abode of light? And where does darkness reside? Can you take me to their places? Do you know the paths to their dwellings? Surely you know, for you were already born. You have lived so many years.
Our second reading is from Colossians chapter 1 and begins at verse 15. It's on page 1676, so Colossians 1, 15 to 23. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. And if you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant.
Thanks, Sarah and Graham. Hello, everyone. Good to see you. My name's Leigh. If we haven't met, I'm one of the ministers here. I'd love you to keep your Bibles open to Colossians. That's where we're going to be spending time this morning. I don't know if you're like me, but have you ever just sat there and wondered what life would be like without certain things, like colour or cars or coffee? I don't know if you're like that. I am. My mind goes there. What about bees? What would life be like without bees? Well, actually, it'd be very problematic. Without going into the details, because I don't really understand them anyway, there would be some sort of serious ripple effect, and our entire ecosystem would almost collapse, and we would suffer and leave us in a pretty sorry state. Just watch the bee movie, explains it all. What about a world without mirrors? You ever thought about that? No mirrors? That'd be weird. I wouldn't know what I looked like most of the time. It could be good. It's scary. I don't know. Or maybe you've wondered what life would be like without music. Ever thought of a world without music? No musicals. Disney would kind of be terrible. No singing on road trips. No singing in church. Can you imagine that? Yeah, we have had it for a little while. We can sort of imagine what life would be like without music, and people who are deaf can imagine life without music and sound, but it'd be weird. What about a world without smartphones, social media, the internet? Well, some of us sort of remember it. It wasn't maybe that long ago. But if they were suddenly taken away from us now, a lot of us would be a bit shocked by it. What would we do? It'd be a big adjustment. Or maybe more seriously, have you ever wondered what life would be like without a certain person? I often just look at our family over dinner. And even though we're a young family, it's hard to imagine life without each one of them. Well, maybe you don't have to imagine. Maybe you do know what life is like without a certain loved one. And you miss them terribly. Life just isn't the same. It's often true that we don't fully appreciate things or a person until they're gone. But I wonder if you've ever thought that about Jesus. What would life without Jesus be like? How much would you miss him? Would you notice much difference at all? Now, you might be sitting there thinking, give me the mic. I know exactly what life without Jesus is like. I've never had Jesus in my life. I can tell you all about it. Or maybe you've recently become a Christian and you can remember vividly what your life was like before having Jesus in it. Or maybe to some extent you're a Christian, but you do push Jesus out of your life a fair bit. And so you do know what it's like to not have Jesus in your life. Or maybe you are sitting there thinking, I've had Jesus as such a big part of my life for so long, I cannot imagine life without him. Well, wherever you're at, that's the question we're exploring this morning. What would life be like without Jesus? And in the passage that we've read from Colossians, it has a lot to say about that. The first thing is we wouldn't exist. The first thing Paul says is that without Jesus, we wouldn't exist. Look at verse 16 and 17. It's on the screen if you don't have a Bible. For in him, Jesus, all things were created. Jump down a bit. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. When I think about Jesus, I don't often think about him being the creator. That's kind of God, and I don't often think about that being Jesus, but he is before all things, and he did create all things. Jesus is the who in Job 38 that we read about, who laid the earth's foundations, who set limits for the sea, who ordered the morning and the night. If Jesus didn't exist, neither would we. And without Jesus, Paul says, all things would fall apart. He is that powerful that he holds our lives, the whole universe in his hands. He is the glue that holds our entire existence together. But maybe like me, you have this question, well, if Jesus holds all things together, why are so many things falling apart in our world? You don't have to strain your minds too much to think. Ukraine, Afghanistan, and North Korea. Think COVID, cyber sex trafficking, poverty and corruption. Our world is crumbling. Is Jesus really holding it in his hands? Well, the crumbling makes sense because humanity as a whole and individually are trying to live life without Jesus. We're pushing him out of the picture. And so it makes sense that we and the whole creation would experience the effects of that. When our world crumbles, even creation itself earthquakes, animals going extinct, climate change. It's because we're experiencing, in part, what life without Jesus is like. And I want to suggest at that point that it's a loving thing for Jesus to do. If this life is short and eternity is not, either one with Jesus or one without, then it'd be nice to know a little what an eternity without Jesus is going to be like. A taster, a trailer for the real thing. And thankfully, we also get a taste of what life with Jesus is like. Whoever you are, any time we're experiencing creation or things in our lives going the way that we sense they should be and are meant to, we're getting a taste of an eternity with Jesus. Those picturesque days at the beach, the family board game time where no one loses it, when people respect you at work, when you enjoy a meal, those things only happen because Jesus is here and he's holding it all in his hands because he hasn't left us completely. He hasn't let us completely push him away. Things haven't yet fallen apart. And so you may think you're living life without Jesus, but you're not. No one really is. There's no such thing. Not yet, anyway. Secondly, we wouldn't know God. Without Jesus, we wouldn't know God. We wouldn't have a clear picture of who God is. Look at verse 15. Here we go, on the screen for you again. The Son is the image of the invisible God. And verse 19, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. In all the other major religions, the top human figure is there with a message or a word from their God, but Jesus says, I am God. And to many religious people, it's utterly scandalous. It's blasphemous that the Almighty God would come down as a human. But I think it's as beautiful as it is shocking. The Bible tells us that from looking at creation, we can know that God exists and is powerful, but we don't know what he really is like. We don't know who he is. But when we read the biographies of Jesus' life, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we encounter a God who isn't just eternal and powerful creator, but who is humble and gentle, who cares for the widow and orphan, who despises injustice and religion, who wants to be with us, who died to be with us. If we only had creation to go off, our picture of God would be a blurry portion of who he really is. Now you might be thinking, but doesn't the whole Bible reveal God? Yes. But without Jesus, the Bible is like the ingredients, the separate ingredients for a cake. Whereas Jesus is all those ingredients put together, baked, and given substance. And then who makes us appreciate the individual ingredients all the more. The Bible is God's word. Jesus is God's word in the flesh. Because God isn't just a God who speaks from a distance, but who comes down and comes near. And so these words in your Bible, they're our connection to God through Jesus. So without Jesus, a life without Jesus, well, we wouldn't exist and we wouldn't know God. And thirdly, we wouldn't know God. This time, I mean knowing God personally. You know, Jesus gives us a clear picture of who God is, but that's not his ultimate goal. It's not to reveal every last detail about God or give us insight into every thought of God, like he was a specimen to be studied. No, Jesus came so that we would know God relationally, personally. Verses 21 to 22 say, Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. I find these verses hard to swallow, the enemy bit. But every single person, no matter who you are, you, me, everyone else, is or was an enemy of God. Our thoughts and behaviors puts us not just in the category of distant friend, oh, we haven't spoken for a while. No, it puts us in the category of enemies of God. We've believed the lies of God's number one enemy. That's why. Satan. We believe that God doesn't love us, that God isn't good, that God isn't best, that God doesn't care, that God doesn't know, that we don't need him, not all the time, and so have sided with the enemy. But the good news is, we can't, and we don't need to atone for our mistakes, outweigh or undo them with the good. We just need to trust Jesus that through his blood, we're fully reconciled to God. And that's the beauty of these verses, that Jesus reconciles us to God. He forgives us. He so forgives every thought and behavior that is against God, that disregards God, that is ashamed of God, that undermines God, that hates God. All those are so completely forgiven that none of it can enter the picture when it comes to our relationship with God. Think about it like this. If every thought, word, and deed that ignores, betrays, and rubbishes God, if that built a wall between us and God, then Jesus' death doesn't only knock it over, it completely prevents any brick from being laid between us and God ever again. Lastly, without Jesus, our world would be without hope. We would be without hope. Because Jesus is our hope. I haven't put on the screen, but verse 18, he is the head of the church and the beginning and the firstborn, the heir. That's what it means by firstborn. The heir he owns among the dead. In other words, our church and each of our lives are in his hands. In COVID, in persecution, in war, we still have hope, a sure hope, because Jesus holds us in his hands. And because he conquered death, we have a sure hope beyond our own deaths. But the rest of creation has hope too. Look at verse 20. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. The awesome thing about this verse, this little gem, is that the all things that Jesus made and holds together in his hands, the entire universe, our planet, and everything in it, will experience a reconciliation that is tied up with our own reconciliation. This might sound fruity, but it's biblical. So if you've ever felt a connection to creation, certain places, plants, animals, if they just stir something in you, that's a good thing. God wants us to have a connection with creation. Because he does. If you love creation, then those feelings come from Jesus, the creator. If you grieve the terrible state that so much of creation is in, then you're grieving with Jesus. But the wonderful news for creation is that its restoration, its reconciliation is guaranteed because Jesus died for our sins. Creation's fate is tied to our salvation. Paul puts it like this in Romans 8. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. Our reconciliation with God is great news for the rest of creation. And it's great news for us. Our eternity isn't going to be floating on clouds. It's not going to be an eternally long church service in a blindingly white church building. Eternity with Jesus is going to be like the best moments, the most cherished moments in this life, but better, without a blemish. And it's going to be real and earthy and physical. There'll be beaches that produce the best waves, mountains that are filled with the most exciting trails and treks that you could ever go on, forests that are filled with the most extraordinary adventures and creatures and wildlife, plants that produce the most beautiful flowers and fruit that you've ever smelled or tasted, animals and creatures that don't bite or sting, but are friendly. I was thinking about cats and dogs because we love our pets. Most of us, I think, do. And I think our close relationship with dogs and cats particularly is just a taste of the sort of fun and companionship we'll have with all sorts of animals. I don't, and no one knows the exact details, but this creation is going to be liberated. It's going to be free. And I want to be part of that. I love this world in its best moments. And I can't wait. This wonderful news, our reconciliation, the reconciliation of all things by the blood of Jesus, this is the gospel. Jesus laid down his life for us and our world, the world that we've ruined, to restore us and set us free, along with the rest of creation. If you're a Christian, this is the gospel that completely transforms your life. You've heard it, and it's worth sharing with the whole world. It's the true hope our world needs. So let's get out there and proclaim it. Can you imagine a world without Jesus? Probably not. We have no idea how horrible that would be. And sadly, it'll be true that many won't appreciate Jesus until he's completely gone from their lives. But a world completely restored in Jesus? Amazing. If you know Jesus, then let that reality make you rejoice, give you peace in the hope that you have. And let that hope spill over into all of your life. Let me pray. Father, I thank you that you made this world. Jesus, I thank you that you made this world. I thank you that you made each of us. I thank you for both the messages of beauty and destruction and crumbling sent to us. I thank you that you died for us so that we could be restored and reconciled along with the rest of this world. May we rejoice in that and look forward to that hope that we have. May we declare it with our whole lives. And we pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
In Christ alone, we have the image of the invisible God. In Christ alone, we have the firstborn from among the dead. In Christ alone, we have the hope of the reconciliation of the whole of creation. Let's stand and sing of where our hope is found.
Alone, my hope is found. my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we recognize that without you, we have nothing and we are nothing. But in you, we have our being. In you, we have creation. In you, we have the defeat of death. In you, we have the forgiveness of sins and our hope for the future. We give you all our praise, Lord Jesus. Amen. He is our great high priest who lives and pleads for us.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love. Whoever lives and pleads for me, my name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me this depart, no tongue can bid me this depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God.
In today's passage, we're reminded that all these things are ours if we continue in our faith, established and firm, and do not move on from the hope held out for us in the gospel. As we remain standing, we're going to confess the fundamentals, the essentials of the Christian faith in the Apostles' Creed. Let's declare together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please have a seat, and Gloria Williams is going to lead us in prayer for our church and our world.
Morning. Let's pray. Lord, we know that you are Lord of all, you rule and you are sovereign. We ask, Lord, please guide the course of world events and give us, your people, the joy and peace of serving you in freedom. Lord, we pray for the situation in Ukraine. As the situation continues to escalate, we pray for peace, a quick resolution and little loss of life. Father, we pray for the citizens, particularly the most vulnerable. Please give them safety and please provide for their needs. Pray for wisdom and humility for all the leaders involved. And we pray at this time that many might hear the gospel, turn to you and find the joy and hope that is only in Jesus. Father, we also pray for our brothers and sisters in Syria. We know that they face daily persecution, and in some cases, church buildings are completely destroyed. We pray that we know that many face rejection and persecution from converting from Islam to Christianity, and many are under significant pressure. Lord, please bring peace to this country. Please protect the Christians. Please help the church leaders to have wisdom as they guide our people at this time. And please protect those who have left Islam. Lord, we pray for us here at All Saints as we start small groups for the year. We pray, Lord, that these places will be where we love one another deeply. Help us to get to know each other. Please bless the friendships that are being formed in these groups. We pray that in these groups that we may grow in grace, that we can continue to encourage each other and keep growing in our knowledge and love of you. Lord, we also pray for those amongst us with long-term health challenges. Would you give us courage and strength, and each day help us to find the grace that we need. For those who are hurting from relationship breakdowns, financial difficulties, and mental health issues, we pray, Lord, that you'll gently cover us with your love and care. Would you bring friends close to us who can love us and support us, and give us unwavering faith as we keep following you. Father, please change us, make us more like your Son. Grow us in wisdom and prayerfulness, and help us to regularly spend time on our knees, confessing our sins to you. And help us to find time in our busy days and in our weeks to spend with you and to grow in joy as we wait for Jesus' return. In his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. On the screen is a Connect card, so if you'd like to be in touch with us, whether you're watching online or in the building, feel free to head to that website, scan the QR code, and be in touch. At All Saints, we have a number of partnerships to help us impact the world with Christ's love. We've heard today of the majesty and the rule and the love of God seen particularly in his Son, Jesus. And one of those partnerships that we have is with Greenacre Anglican Church, Good Shepherd Anglican. And so today we're having a little update on how we have been involved and what they've been trying to do to reach out to others with the news of Jesus in their local area, particularly those in need. So we'll see a little video and then we'll spend some time praying for Greenacre. Thanks, Aaron.
So here we are at Greenacre Anglican Church. Because of COVID, their food bank has needed to be a drive-through. I went and I collected some bread from a top-ride bakery that I know. And here are the food hampers that All Saints has generously provided for families who were in isolation. So the team there would give people a bag of food from the Anglicare Food Bank, and then they would take some time to chat with them, see how they're going, see if they had any other needs that they might be able to help out with, see if there was anything that they could pray for them, and then they would take time to talk to God for the person. Each of the bags had attached to it some words of Jesus, in English or in Arabic, words from the Bible to encourage people at this time. Now, some people couldn't drive to pick up the food, so here is the team who would personally take food to people's homes to deliver it to those people who were in isolation or couldn't drive. The team at Greenacre wants to say thank you so much for your support and for praying for them, and please ask that they would be a light in their community, shining Jesus to the people at Greenacre. Thank you.
So I'm so thankful for your support and our support of the church in Greenacre. Another way we can express our support is for this year, they are keen to start some community lunches. So after their church service on Sunday morning, have a big lunch, invite members of the community so that they can build relationships with them and hopefully introduce Jesus to them. How we might be able to help is to go along and do kind of the back end, do the barbecue setup and cooking the food and serving food and things like that, so that the members of Greenacre can spend their time connecting with the local community. If that's something that you'd be interested in being involved, either respond through the newsletter or come and have a chat to me. Let me spend some time praying for our partners in Greenacre. Heavenly Father, thank you that Jesus is news worth sharing and that his love drives us to seek others to know that love as well. And so I pray for the church in Greenacre. We thank you for the what they're doing to seek Jesus being known to many. We thank you for all those whom they could support with the food drive. We pray that that glimpse of the love of Jesus may stir them to think and want to investigate more on who their Saviour is. We pray for their further outreach ministry, that as a church family, they may connect deeply with the people who have been connected through many of their ministries. And we pray also for the local outreach to Muslims during the month of Ramadan, that much fruit may be born through those connections and that people may see the wonder and the love of Jesus. We pray that through some building works, they may make their space more inviting for people. And we pray for Grant, the senior minister, and his family with their recovery from COVID. May they you sustain them and fully heal them for their health, so they may serve you with gladness. We pray that us as a church here will continue to support the church in Greenacre so that many may come and bow the knee before Jesus to your honour and glory. Amen. A couple of announcements before I step down. From next week, we've had a lovely time, an extended time over summer, all together in the morning. From next week, we'll return to our two services, 9 and 10:30. If you have children, the children will start in. So bring your kids to this space and we'll start all together as church before the kids head down to Cornerstone later on. And if you're watching at home, the live stream will only be at 9 o'clock. Of course, you can watch the live stream at 10:30 or later in the day if you wish, but we'll just have the one live stream and put our resources into that from next Sunday onwards. So 9 or 10:30 next Sunday. And finally, our midweek service is on this week, on Thursday. And so if you'd like a more traditional style of service, you're most welcome to come along to that this Thursday. Well, our final song for this morning points us to the new creation to come and Jesus in all his glory that we've been reminded of in God's word today. Let's encourage one another as we wait to see Jesus coming. Please stand.
Seats. That brings us to the end of the structured part of church this morning, but please do hang around for some morning tea. It'll be available from the servery, and let's use the space outside as well to enjoy morning tea together. We've been reminded today of Jesus, the living one who lives forever and ever, in whom all things were made and through whom all things will be remade. So this week, let's go in peace. Can we have the slide, Harry? Let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.